Assalamu Alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah wahdahu as-salatu was-salamu ala man la nabiyya ba'da. Sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in amma ba'd. فقد قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الصيام جنة أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي يا فتاح يا عليم. In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful, all praises due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has created us, sustained us, has blessed us with iman, and has given us the ability to be gathered here in His remembrance. All praises due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has made us from amongst the ummah of His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his companions, his family, and all the prophets before him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect those of us who choose to tread in their path. So the topic for tonight's talk is how to prepare for Ramadan. With Ramadan less than 2 weeks away, each and every single one of us should essentially be ending our preparation for the month of Ramadan. If we look at the ahadith and if we look at the practices of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see that from the month of Rajab, he would essentially increase the level of worship that he used to do in preparation for the month of Ramadan. And it is something that should speak to each and every single one of us, that if a man like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who kept his worship at a very high level throughout the entire year, if someone like him felt that I should prepare myself even more for the month of Ramadan, then each and every single one of us should take notice of that as well. What I want to do is sort of divide this talk into four particular parts, and it is basically four tips that each and every single one of us can adopt, we can do to prepare ourselves before the month of Ramadan begins. And by doing so, inshallah, when the month of Ramadan begins, we will be at our optimum level and we will not be in a state of shock, either spiritually or physically, when the month of Ramadan begins. And we will be able to take advantage of every single moment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, inshallah, bless each and every single one of us. So the first tip is the month of Ramadan is the month of the Quran. Very often what we try to do is equate Ramadan with fasting. Yes, fasting is a very big part of the month of Ramadan, but we have to understand that the month of Ramadan was honored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because it was the month that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to reveal the Quran to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Before Ramadan was the month of fasting, Ramadan was the month of the Quran. Primarily, it is still the month of the Quran. Now, the Quran is something that for 11 months of the year, most of us do not have a connection with. Even those of us who are huffaz are not able to recite maybe as much as we would like to. For many of us, the Quran might be something we recite in Salah. It might be something we pick up on Friday to recite Surah Kahf, or to recite Surah Yasin, or to recite Surah Mulk, or to recite Surah Waqia. Whatever daily practices that we might have, more or less, we can very confidently say that out of the month of Ramadan, our connection with the Quran is very weak. Now, the negative effect of that is that we lose focus and we lose a connection with what the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. The Quran is essentially 114 letters to each and every single one of us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are not like the Catholics where only the clergy have access to the Bible. The Quran is for every single believing man and woman. So if we ourselves, personally, as an individual, do not have a connection with the Quran, we will not be able to realize, or we will not be able to actualize what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's message is to each and every single one of us. We will not have a direct connection to the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the reason why the Quran should be emphasized in the month of Ramadan is because of the verse that I had began with. يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. A verse that we are all very familiar with, that, O you who believe, fasting has been made mandatory upon you, just like the people before you, so that you achieve taqwa. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins by saying, do not fear, fasting is an act of worship that the people before you have done as well. So it is not anything new. But more so to the point, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. The reason why I, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, am telling you to fast is so that you achieve taqwa. Now, taqwa is generally translated as fear, but it is an incomplete translation. Fear is a part of taqwa, but the general framework of taqwa is to create a consciousness of awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the sun was setting, each and every single one of us was aware that we have to come to the masjid and pray, or that we have to pray maghrib. In other words, our taqwa informed us that at this very given moment, this is the commandment of Allah. And that is what taqwa is. It creates a consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within us, that every single given moment in our life, we will be able to realize what Allah wants us to do, what Allah does not want us to do. And the way taqwa is achieved is by fasting, but also primarily through the Qur'an. If a person reads the Qur'an, if a person starts connecting himself with the Qur'an on a more personal level, they will understand what Allah wants from him or her. Now, it is not enough to just recite the Qur'an. Many of us might not know more than 20 surahs. Many of us might not know more than 30 surahs. Many of us might be just proficient at reading the Qur'an. Not everybody has the fortune to be a hafiz. But at the same time, reading the Qur'an is not sufficient if a person does not understand what the Qur'an is trying to tell them. To that effect, the first step that we have to take in ensuring that we have a personal relationship with the Qur'an, after making sure that we read on a very regular basis, we have to understand what the Qur'an is telling each and every single one of us. Now, I'm not saying that we have to become scholars. I'm not saying we have to memorize the translation of the Qur'an. But at the very least, what we can do is begin looking at the translation of the surahs we recite the most in salah. The last 10 surahs are surahs that each and every single one of us have memorized when we were young. And we have memorized even more than that. We know Surah Fatiha. But how many of us know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in Surah Fatiha? Surah Fatiha is very interesting. Chronologically speaking, it's not the first surah that was revealed. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for that to introduce the entire Qur'an. It is the preface, it is the introduction. Now imagine, the first point of contact between any person and Allah is the Qur'an and in effect Surah Fatiha. What do you do when you pick up a book? You start from the very beginning. When you want to have a summary of the book, when you want to know what the book is telling you or what the book is talking about, you read the blurb in the back of the book. Surah Fatiha summarizes every single thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about in the Qur'an. And it is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for it to introduce the rest of the Qur'an. And how many of us actually know the translation of Surah Fatiha? Can you imagine the benefits of it, that when you are standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you are praying and you say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, you know what you are reciting. You know what you are reciting. When you are reciting, Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar, you know what you are reciting. Learning the translation of at least the surahs that each and every single one of us have memorized will help us in our salah, will enhance our concentration, and will forge a deeper level of connection with the Qur'an. The Qur'an is something that teaches us our shortcomings. Where am I deficient? What do I not do out of the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What am I not practicing? What am I practicing but could improve on? Now these things seem very repetitive, that we know all these things about the Qur'an. But the reason why it should be emphasized is because Ramadan is the garden
is the month in which our hearts are prepared for the other 11 months. The Quran softens the heart. Now it's summertime. Many people might have gardens here, and you might be, you know, planting your own fruits and vegetables. After a long winter, you don't immediately throw your seeds into the garden. You make sure that it is clean. You pull out all the weeds. You make sure that the soil is proper. You make sure that it will get adequate sunlight. You make sure that it will get water. You make sure that if the soil is not good enough, that you get added fertilizer. You make sure that it is at optimum level. And then you plant your seeds. The Quran prepares our hearts so that whatever blessings and whatever good that we attain in the month of Ramadan takes hold in our hearts. It takes hold, and then the fruits of it is something that we benefit from the other 11 months of the year. If the heart is not soft enough to accept whatever blessings and benefits we are getting within Ramadan, what's it going to do? It's just going to be on the surface of our hearts. And after Ramadan, when we get back into our usual regular daily schedule, slowly, slowly our hearts will return to the original state, to the state it was in before the month of Ramadan. To prepare our hearts, to prepare ourselves, to ensure that we take advantage of every single given moment, the Quran is the first step. It will prepare ourselves spiritually, it will prepare ourselves mentally. To that effect, one practical step that each and every single one of us can take is starting from today until the month of Ramadan begins, we should recite the Quran at least 5 minutes every day. And not Surah Fatiha and not Surah Nas, not the surahs that you recite in Salah. All of us have smartphones. Even if you do not have a smartphone, it's fine. But if you have a smartphone, most likely you have a Quran app. Open up the app when you are waiting for prayer, or when you are stuck in traffic, when you are in your daily commute. Open up the Quran and just recite one page and bookmark it. And then read another page the next day. Don't give yourself the excuse that I am out of practice. And this is precisely the excuse everybody uses, or most people use when Ramadan begins. That I am out of practice. If I have to sit down and start reciting now, it is going to take me an hour to recite 5 pages because I am not used to reciting. Let's not use that excuse. Start reciting the Quran 5 minutes every single day before the month of Ramadan begins. And when the month of Ramadan begins, inshallah, you will be able to recite more fluently because you will get used to it again. And even if you think that you will not be able to finish an entire khatam, that you won't be able to recite the entire 30 juz on your own in the month of Ramadan, don't use that as an excuse not to read the Quran as well. It is not farz to recite the entire Quran in the month of Ramadan. It is certainly recommended if you are able to do so. But let's not use that as an excuse that, oh, I won't be able to finish the entire 30 juz, so I'm not going to read it anyway. No, even if you recite 15 juz the entire month of Ramadan, forge a connection with the Quran. That was point number one. Point number two, Ramadan is the month of fasting. It is the month of fasting. It is the month that we are commanded to fast, and it is a month that is wholly different from the other 11 months of the year. Not only because of the environment, not only because of how we perceive ourselves to be, not only because of what we are told to do, that we fast during the day and pray Taraweeh at night, but there's a special effect that fasting creates within a person, which is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded each and every single one of us to fast. Fasting creates a sense of awareness, a consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but at the same time, it is a shield. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith al-Qudsi quotes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that fasting is a shield. The purpose of a shield is that it protects you. The stronger the shield, the stronger it can withstand any attack. If your shield is not strong, it will not be able to withstand any attack. If a person's fasting is a real fast, is a fast where he is actually trying his best to keep himself away from any bad habits that he has, from any sins that he usually commits, and tries to devote himself to all the good, and tries to devote himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that fast will in effect be a shield for that person. The reason why fasting is such a high-ranked act of worship is because it is an act of worship that none of us can see. If you are standing in the masjid or you are standing anywhere and you prostrate and you make ruku', a person looking at you can say, this person is praying. But when you and I are fasting, there is no physical sign that says that this person is fasting. You are in a perpetual state of worship. You are worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every single moment from dawn to dusk. And it is an act of worship that nobody can see. Which is why in that same hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, because it is an act of worship that none of you can see, the only reward that I can give that person is myself. In other words, if a person fasts, the only reward that person will get is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. And it is amazing. There's no other act of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares such a thing for. What we have to understand that when Ramadan begins, our first instinct is fasting of the body, right? That we stay hungry from suhoor until iftar. But fasting is not merely fasting of the body. Yes, we stay away from food and drink. But our fast will not be a fast if our tongues and eyes and ears and limbs are not fasting along as well. If our daily schedule, if our daily actions in Ramadan are the same as it was before Ramadan, our fast will be equivalent to us staying hungry the entire day. The entire reason a person is supposed to fast and is supposed to exercise patience is that they are supposed to become aware of the sins that their tongues, our tongues, commit on a daily basis. The sins that our eyes commit on a daily basis. The sins that our ears commit on a daily basis. When a person is prevented from food and drink, then they slowly start to realize that my other limbs should also fast as well. What we also have to understand is that fasting, it is not just an act of worship that is supposed to be in the month of Ramadan. The effects of fasting is supposed to be something that we carry on even after the month of Ramadan begins. Fasting is just a mechanism. It is just a mechanism that draws us closer to Allah, and that awareness that we gain, the taqwa that we gain through fasting during Ramadan, is supposed to be carried on after the month of Ramadan as well. What do we do to prepare for this? We usually do not fast outside of Ramadan. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to fast on Mondays and Thursdays and few other days during the entire year. The reason? Because he wanted to keep his body connected to the act of worship that is fasting. Most of us don't fast outside of the month of Ramadan. Now think about it logically. Ramadan is in the middle of summer. Our fast is going to be easily 15 to 16 hours. If our first fast is going to be on the first day of Ramadan, you are going to put your body in a state of shock. By 10 o'clock, by 12 o'clock, you will be thirsty, you will be hungry, you will be irritable, you will not want to do anything, you will shut yourself inside your house or inside your room with the air condition on, so you try to conserve as much energy as possible, you don't want to talk to anybody, you will come out of your room right before iftar so that you can eat immediately. You have no energy to do anything else. To make sure that our bodies are physically prepared, or at least aware of the fact that this is how they will have to be for the next 29-30 days, before the month of Ramadan begins, each and every single one of us should fast at least one day. It doesn't have to be on a Monday, it doesn't have to be on a Thursday. If you are free on the weekends, just fast on the weekend. At least one day. At least one day. Get your body used to the fact that this is how it will have to be in the month of Ramadan. You don't want your body to go in a state of shock when Ramadan begins. And also, a lot of us have coffee habits. It is farz for us to have a cup of coffee in the morning, otherwise we don't function. It is farz for us to have a cup of tea in the morning, or we don't function. For some people, it might be cigarettes, that they have to have a smoke in the morning. These things you can't do when you're fasting. I hope we do realize that. But to make sure that you are not caffeine deprived and that you don't have a headache, try to make sure that you space out your coffee breaks, that you start cutting down slowly, slowly. If you're on the habit of drinking coffee 3 times a day, cut it down to 2 times a day, cut it down to 1 a day, just so you are a little prepared when the month of Ramadan begins. Each and every single one of us can testify to the fact that for the past couple of years, we have all complained and we have all been concerned, how are we going to fast this Ramadan? The days are getting longer, it is getting hotter, we are going to become dehydrated, we won't be able to drink any water. But subhanAllah, after the first couple of days, everybody gets used to it. And it is a mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything that Allah tells us to do is not beyond our capabilities. But at the same time, ibadah is not supposed to be an act of hardship. It is not supposed to be something that sends our bodies into shock. So whatever habits that we have, we should try to make sure that we address it in a smart way. That we try to space out our lunch, our breaks, our breakfast, our coffees, our tea, our cigarettes, just so that when the month of Ramadan begins, we are able to address those in a very smart way. And to also keep in mind, our diets, usually, desis, for the most part, our diets are not good. And given the fact that we will be fasting for 15 and 16 hours a day, the first thing that you want to eat after Allahumma laka sumtu wa bika amantu wa ala rizqika aftartu is a lot of oil. That's not good either. We have to be smart about our bodies. Our bodies are an amana from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are a trust from Allah. The first thing that we have to make sure is at least that our bodies are hydrated. Have ample water from Taraweeh until Suhoor. Make sure that your body replenishes all the water it has lost during the day. Be smart about what you eat. Have more fruits. Space out your meals a little more so that you have enough energy to pray Taraweeh, but not too full to pray Taraweeh. A lot of times our iftars are feasts, which is fine if you want to eat. But at the same time, it shouldn't prevent you from praying Taraweeh at the optimum level. At the end of the day, fasting is also something that is supposed to make us aware of the small blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given each and every single one of us. When the clock hand strikes iftar and we drink that first sip of water, we are supposed to remember that so many people around the world do not have access to water, that so many people around the world do not have access to clean water. When we are eating, we have to understand that so many people are not blessed with the amount of food that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put in front of each and every single one of us. That even if we do not have food in our fridges, we have the money in our pocket to go buy what we want for ourselves and for our family. Many people around the world go hungry, have to fast involuntarily every single day because they don't have food to make iftar. So we should make sure that fasting is not just about staying hungry. It's also about being aware, becoming aware of the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, but at the same time, being smart about how we fast. That was point number two. Point number three, Ramadan is a time to spend with family and community. During the summer months, for the youth, we are on holiday and we should take advantage of that time to spend with our families, with our siblings, with our parents, people who we usually do not get to see during the entire school year. At the very least, iftar, the time of iftar, the activity of iftar, should be a family affair. It shouldn't only be the moms and the aunts and the sisters cooking inside the kitchen. You know, if your mom trusts you with a stove to do something in the kitchen, you can help her out. At the very least, what you can do is set the table. Make sure the plates are out, make sure the cups are out, make sure the spoons are there, make sure the waters are in the jug, bringing food from the dining room to the kitchen. You know, just spending some time with the family. And this is for the men folk as well, that family should be what is incorporated during iftar. It is a time, it is a month where the bonds of family is supposed to be strengthened. And the same goes for community as well. Most of us, we will be very invested in our own masajid, right? Whether as people who are responsible, whether as committee members, whether as people who are responsible for the iftars, whatever the case might be. We will be very invested in our masajid, in trying to make sure that our community has a very good Ramadan. And it is a very, very blessed thing to do. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward each and every single person who devotes themselves to such an activity. But at the same time, Ramadan is also a time for self-reflection, a time for self-improvement, that we shouldn't become so busy in trying to make sure that everything is running smoothly that we forget ourselves during the month of Ramadan. As the organizer of any conference, of any convention, that if they have heard even a fraction, even a quarter of the talks that took place in a convention, and they will say, I wasn't able to. Why? Because they were running around and trying to make sure that everything was running as smoothly as possible. So even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with the opportunity to serve our community, to organize interfaith iftars, to organize fundraising, to organize other projects for our community, we should not forget to take some time out of the entire day for ourselves. We should not forget to pray nawafil for ourselves. We should not forget to connect with the Quran for ourselves. It is not enough that our Ramadan is just about fasting and is just about serving the community. It is very, very rewarding. But at the same time, it is also a month for you to ensure that you improve, that you become a better person so that you can serve your community even better after the month of Ramadan as well. Each and every single one of us always has room for improvements. We are never a finished product. Iman, our level of iman, our level of practice and belief is never a finished product. There's always a level to overcome. There are always obstacles to overcome. We should never become content with the fact that I am in a good place, that the level of worship that I do is sufficient. No, we should always have the yearning, we should always have the enthusiasm to increase whatever acts of worship that we do, to improve the quality of whatever acts of worship that we do. The last point, and this is probably the most important point, Ramadan is a time for asking. It's a time for asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what we usually call dua. If I had to ask every single person here, name your top 10 du'as, we will not be able to rattle them off. In other words, we will not be able to just recite them without thinking. Our usual du'as are, رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. It is the most complete du'a any person can make. Right? Oh Allah, give me all the good in this world, give me all the good in the hereafter, and save me from the hellfire. Right? Is the most complete dua any person can make. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also aware of every single dua that we have ever made in our lives, that we have ever will make, that we are making right now. Allah knows every single one of our heart's desires, whether we even admit it to ourselves or not. Allah knows. But there's a difference between Allah knowing and Allah wanting us to ask Him. How many of us actually know what to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for? And I speak from personal experience. In February, I had the fortune to go for Umrah. And as custom that before you travel, you ask people, do you want me to make dua for you? A, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a hadith of that is recorded in Tirmidhi said that three people's dua is accepted. Number one, a person who is traveling, a person who is fasting, and the parents' dua for their children. So, I am traveling, and more than that, I am traveling to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will be standing in front of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I will be making dua. So I asked people, what dua, do you have any dua requests? So people started sending in their dua requests through Facebook, through email, through texting. And to make sure that I didn't forget anybody, I started writing everything down. I didn't want to take my phone inside the haram because it will just be another distraction. So I started writing all my du'as down on a piece of paper. After I finished writing all the du'a requests down, it came up to like 2 pages. I started thinking, what if I make the same list for myself? You know, let me just sit down for 5 minutes and let me just think to myself, what do I want to ask Allah when I am standing in front of His house? So I started writing all the du'as that I want to ask Allah. And it required a moment of critical honesty. If you are not honest with yourself, if you do not want to admit that you want to ask certain things of Allah, that you have problems that you do not want to admit yourself, and you do not want to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help, you find all those things and you write it down. I wrote down about a half, almost a page of du'as that I wanted to make for myself. Then I started writing du'as for my parents. I want to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all these things for my parents, and then for my siblings, and then for my immediate family, then for my second family, cousins. Then I wanted to ask for my communities, the different communities that I work with, the different organizations that I work with, the acquaintances that I have. And then you can just expand it. Start making a list of all the people who do not like Islam. Pamela Geller, Sean Hannity, Bill O'Reilly, every single one of them that comes up every single day, their 5 minutes of fame. Write down their names. When was the last time any of us made dua for them? That, oh Allah, grant them hidayah. Oh Allah, grant them guidance. Instead of hating on them, instead of going on epic rants on Facebook about them, when was the last time any of us made dua for Pamela Geller? All right, that, oh Allah, give her hidayah. And this is not as a joke, because dua is not for just the people you like. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua for the people who stoned him out of the city of Taif. Allahumma arhamni qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, bless my people because they do not know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam still made dua for them. So the dua is not only for the people, reserved for the people that you like. It is also for the people that you do not like, that you hate, that you dislike, that you have a different political view from. It's for everybody. It's for the entire ummah. The reason for mentioning this story, before the month of Ramadan begins, each and every single one of us should take at least 5 minutes a day, or just 1 minute a day. We all have smartphones. Just open up a note in your phone and add a couple of du'as whenever you remember. I want to ask Allah to do this. I want to ask Allah to help me pass this exam. I want to ask Allah to help me find a job. I want to ask Allah to bless my parents. I want to ask Allah to help me find some community work. I want to ask Allah for this personal problem. Just, start listing. You will surprise even yourself the amount of things that you would want to ask Allah for. The only thing we have to do is just start writing it down. Number one, we will remember what to ask Allah for. But number two, we will surprise ourselves with the amount of need we have of Allah. If our daily du'as are, oh Allah, give guidance to the ummah, have mercy on my parents and myself. Alhamdulillah, those are very great du'as. I'm not downplaying the importance of those du'as. But like I said, Allah wants specificity. Allah knows what you want to ask. Allah wants you to ask that. Do you realize what you want? Do you realize what you want? Are you aware of the need that you have in your life? A physical need, a spiritual need, a mental need, a financial need. The different needs that each and every single one of us have can be addressed through dua. The only way we will be able to make dua is if we know what to make dua for. To that effect, before Ramadan begins, start making a list. It doesn't have to be public. It is just between you and Allah. You don't have to share with anybody. And make dua for everybody. Ask people, can I make dua for you this Ramadan? And it might sound like a joke, but think about it. The Prophet ﷺ said that if a person makes dua for his brother, the angels will also say Ameen for that very dua for that particular person. Make dua for each other, make dua for another person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you the same. So just to recap very quickly the steps that each and every single one of us can take to prepare for the month of Ramadan. Number one, Quran. Let's connect ourselves with the Quran. Let's make it such that after the month of Ramadan, we have a better connection, a stable connection, a connection that we can nurture throughout the entire 11 months. It is not something that we should just leave at the end of Ramadan. Like I mentioned, the Quran is something that is a personal message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us. And it is personally addressed to each and every single one of us. So how are we going to know what Allah is telling you and I if we do not recite the Quran? And anytime you have a question, ask your imam. The imam sahib is here, right? That I don't understand what Allah is trying to tell me here. Enhance your own understanding of the Quran, gain an appreciation of the Quran. Number two, fast at least one day before the month of Ramadan begins. It is a very arduous physical activity. It is not something to be taken lightly, but at the same time, it is not beyond our capabilities. All we have to do is just practice. Ramadan is not a sprint. It's for 30 consecutive days. So you have to know how to pace yourself. If we do not have a sort of schedule or at least an idea of what we want to do in the month of Ramadan, when it begins, we will try to do everything. And we will tire ourselves out even before the first week is out. We have to have some sort of plan, a schedule that works with each and every single one of our schedules. Not everybody will be blessed to have 30 days off. Not everybody is a school student who is on break. A lot of people have to work. They still have jobs. So how are you going to worship Allah even while you are working? And that is something only you can figure out. And the only way you can do so is actually making sure that you take advantage of every single given moment that you will be given throughout the entire day. Number three, Ramadan is a time for family and community. It is a time to forge bonds. It is a time to strengthen the bonds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed between each and every single one of us. We don't know each other. We're not related by blood, maybe not by ethnicity, nationality, language, race, gender, whatever the case might be. The only thing that connects each and every single one of us is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the deen of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is what connects us. And that bond is sufficient. But that bond needs to be nurtured. It should never be taken for granted. The community obviously will try to make sure that every single person is taking advantage of the month of Ramadan through the masjid. But at the same time, if you are in charge of all these events, if you are in charge of all these programs, do not forget about yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also waiting for you to ask Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also waiting for you to come to Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also waiting for you. So don't forget about yourself. Number three, make dua. Make dua. It sounds very basic. It sounds very simple. But dua, wallahi, it is the strongest asset each and every single one of us have, especially in a time like this. And I don't even need to go into details. We are all aware of the state of the Muslim community in America, right? We are all aware of the different challenges that are facing our communities, whether it be internal, whether it be external. And there isn't a day that goes by that we open up our news feeds, that we open up social media, that we turn on the TV, that we don't hear anything negative about Islam or something negative being told about Islam. It's a very toxic, taxing environment. It is very difficult for a person to be optimistic. It's a very dampening environment. It just makes it very difficult sometimes to be grateful, sometimes to be thankful for the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us so much. But at the same time, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Whatever is presented in front of us is well within our potential to overcome, is well within our potential to challenge. And dua is the one asset that will make us understand that at the end of the day, no matter what we do, no matter how the world is, no matter how the world is reacting to us, we have Allah in our corner. We have Allah. And all we have to do is ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His guidance. We have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His help. That it is not enough that we just do. We also have to be aware of why we do what we do. It is not enough that we just have a vision of a community, but the end goal of the community. We want to be a beacon of hope for the people around us. We want to be examples for the people around us. In a time where morality is essentially going down and down and down and down every single day, where it is just falling very, very rapidly, where ethics seem to be changing every single day, where it is very difficult now to even distinguish what is right and wrong, when it is very difficult to even speak out for what is right and against what is wrong, because people have it opposite. What is wrong is now being considered right. What was right is now being considered wrong. Numerous examples that we can all bring up, but we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us dua simply so that we can know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always there for us. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and protect us. May He give us knowledge that benefits us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first of all give me the ability, give us all the ability to take advantage of every single moment that we have before the month of Ramadan, to prepare for the month of Ramadan. That when the month of Ramadan begins, that we take advantage of every single blessed moment. That the good that we accumulate during the month of Ramadan is something that we can carry on after the month. Wallahu a'lam wa billahi tawfiq. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.